Hi, welcome back. Close up, everyone. Joined by the party chairs for the Republican and the Democratic Party here in New Hampshire, who just spent the break going over their cell phone to source each other's information on this. But we are going to move forward to a different topic and some of the issues that happened today and that, or this week, I should say. Let's talk about the gas tax. That was instituted, it went into effect this week, Chairman Buckley. And it did pass with bipartisan support.
It was a Republican-sponsored bill.
And sure. And it was also, you know, the money was meant to go to road projects, things along those lines. But now we're hearing that Washington, you know, the Highway Trust Fund might be going broke, which seems to be, you know, a bit of a bitter pill for motorists here in New Hampshire to swallow, given the fact that they're doing their share and Washington can't figure it out.
Well, no matter what's going on in Washington, the fact is that we have an enormous number of bridges that are redlined, that are in danger, and the people of New Hampshire certainly do not want their children going across bridges on the way to school that can collapse, which was what happened in Minneapolis a couple years ago. The people of New Hampshire understand that we have to invest in infrastructure. That was the great investment of Republican President Eisenhower. Now the Republicans don't want to spend a penny on roads, don't want to spend a penny on bridges. And that's not going to help our economic development in New Hampshire in any way. So having the first tax increase in over 20 years, having it at 4 cents at a period of time where the gas prices are fluctuating from one gas station to another, right on South Willow Street near where I live, there was a 15-cent difference the other day between gas pumps. So four cents, meaning literally maybe 40 cents, 50 cents a fill up towards making sure that we've got solid roads and solid roads for economic development and solid bridges to keep our children safe. I think it's a good investment. And so didn't the Republicans in the Senate and the House.
If that investment is ultimately made, you want to talk about this a little bit, Jennifer? Obviously, Washington kind of holds the cards right now with the Highway Trust Fund, which stands to become insolvent by fall.
Sure. Well, first I would say it was a McKinsey study that I was referencing earlier on Obamacare, and that it indicated about 74% of the folks who have signed up under Obamacare may have had health insurance previously to this.
May.
So that's the likely to have had health insurance previous to having signed up for Obamacare. As far as
the gas tax
goes, the fact that we have a gas tax now in New Hampshire is a result of a lack of leadership from Governor Hassan on this issue and so many others. And we see it reflected again from Senator Shaheen, who just last week indicated that she's open to the idea of a increased federal gas tax.
I have to ask you about it because I did talk to her this week and she said that is not the answer.
And yet she did make that statement last week when she was doing an event at one of our highway project sites here in New Hampshire. There is a plan that her name is not on at this point, that is working its way through the Senate right now, that would almost double the federal gas tax. It's $3.99 per gallon to fill up your car with gas in the city of Nashville, where I live right now. This gas tax is something that touches every single resident of our state and hurts every single resident of our state. We can solve the problems that we face with our roads and our highways if we more responsibly manage the funds that we have. Even Governor Lynch, a moderate Democrat, was opposed to the gas tax. And even he said in 2007 that we need to better manage the funds we have, not further burden and hurt the families and the businesses of New Hampshire.
Chairman Buckley?
I think what the chair of the Republican Party is really saying is that it hurts the tourists. And since she's running a ticket full of tourists, that she's really more concerned about the Massachusetts tourists that are up here, whether it's Mitt Romney or it's Scott Brown that are coming up here. In Massachusetts, the state of her ticket actually has a significantly higher gas tax, as does a lot of the other states in the Northeast. The fact remains is there's no plan on the Republican side to fix the bridges and roads. There's no plan to actually do anything. It's the sort of strong leadership of Governor Hassan that is actually going to be addressing these problems. That's what leadership is, not just sitting back and saying, I'm not going to fix anything, I'm not going to do anything, and we're not going to try to move this state or country forward.
Go ahead, 30 seconds.
Sure. Listen, Mr. Buckley's very good at the snide and snarky comments that really don't further the conversation, not so good at solving problems. And I suppose he could be forgiven having spent a lifetime as a political operative and not understanding how this increase in gas not only hurts families that are balancing their own budgets, but businesses that are trying to grow new jobs in New Hampshire. After an incredibly long time of Democratic leadership in the corner office, our state is 36th in the nation for businesses. And I think it's time that we not only hire somebody else to do the job, but that we take a different approach.
I do want to move on.
But that we take a different approach to how we work.
What
here.
Is that approach?
It is about responsibly managing the funds
What's
that
the
we
plan?
Have. And it is about.
What's the plan?
And it is about taking a much
Chairman
more
Buckley,
fiscally
with all due respect,
responsible.
Let her finish.
Approach.
And she's not a candidate here. But I do want to bring something up.
Gibberish.
You talk about Scott Bryan, talk about Mitt Romney.
You know what I always find very interesting with Mr. Buckley when he's talking
to me? She wants to talk over me now. And, you know, she wants to attack the fact that I served 18 years in the legislature. You know, I know. I'm from New Hampshire. It's something she's not really accustomed to
Speaking
talking to people that
from New
care about New Hampshire.
I want to talk about Walt Havenstein. You had indicated not too long ago that you had serious doubts about the qualifications of Walt Havenstein being eligible to run for governor. Ballot Law Commission decided, yes, he is eligible, in fact, to do
three
so.
In
a 3-2 vote, but I do want to point out that the third vote, the tie-breaking vote, came from a member of the Democratic Party. Mm-hmm. So it would seem to be that this argument about who lives where might have been decided by the Ballot Law Commission to a certain degree. And do you think that perhaps, as others have suggested, that they don't have the authority to make that decision?
That's up to for other people to decide that. We responded, the party responded to Walt's own complaint against himself that went before the Ballot Law Commission. Listen, as I've said many times, either he's not eligible to run for governor of New Hampshire or he committed tax fraud in the state of Maryland. Either way, what I found was most interesting is that in his testimony, he kept saying he couldn't remember. He couldn't remember that he signed this form. He couldn't remember if he took this tax cut. He couldn't remember what he'd done. Then you're talking about he doesn't know how, let's say, government operates. He doesn't know that the governor doesn't have anything to do with a constitutional amendment. He doesn't know how the budget is prepared. He doesn't know anything about New Hampshire because he's from Maryland.
Your thoughts on the ruling by the Ballot?
Well, the commission has spoken and the answer is clear. I think that it's really convenient for the Democrats to have these types of issues that they can try to manipulate and turn into something that they're not when they're not able to run on their own record. The candidate on the Democratic side is going to be somebody who wasn't able to balance the budget, needed the Senate Republicans to step forward and do the job for her. Somebody who decided that a legislative priority coming out of the gate was going to be to repeal an equal education opportunity law that would allow some of our most economically vulnerable children the opportunity for better education. Somebody who thought that we should assume $80 million in revenues from an industry that wasn't even, and by the way, today is not illegal in our state. And the Republican ticket will offer the voters an alternative in November. And as far as Mr. Buckley's comments and personally derogatory comments about one of these candidates, I find it really disturbing that every time that Mr. Buckley and I end up on next to each other on a stage, that he devolves into that kind of conversation. I think one of the reasons people in New Hampshire and people in this country have disengaged from politics to the degree that they have is because of that snotty, snarky, unprofessional approach that so many people bring to the conversation. I think we have to be careful when he has repeatedly made the suggestion that Mr. Havenstein may have committed tax fraud. Tax fraud is a felon. If he wants to come out and accuse Mr. Havenstein of being a felon, then he should do it and he should back it up. It's not acceptable. It's not acceptable to the people in our state, and it shouldn't be acceptable to the people
We're
that he works for.
We're just about out of time, and that certainly deserves some time for a response, Chairman Buckley.
Jennifer would rather talk about me than defend what she says because the facts just don't back up any of the comments and attacks and personal attacks that she does. We're going to have a great year. Senator Shaheen, Governor Hassan, Congresswoman Shea Porter, Congressman Custer, our executive council, the House, the Senate, we're going to have a terrific year because we have a terrific record to run on. All of these leaders, true leaders, have moved forward. There is no Republican plan other than to say no. People of New Hampshire aren't going to fall for that. They're not going to fall for the phony outrage that she's now expressing here. She understands that when she makes up stuff, we're going to call her out on it, just like we're going to call out her candidates when they make up things. That's the New Hampshire way, making sure that the people of New Hampshire provide reality, truth, and the strong record of their elected officials.
Josh, the Republicans are going to offer voters a better alternative in November. The failed Democratic leadership of our state isn't working, and good, strong, fiscally conservative candidates in the House, in the state Senate,
We're going to have a primary, obviously, in September. We're going to see what happens in the general election. I got to wrap this up. I apologize, but certainly, folks, if you missed the fireworks on Friday, there you go.